said, I got it, coach. You know, we're not going anywhere, and they're staying here. You know, there was one or two, but not much, and I think that's a big part of it. But I think the unity of the whole class was important. They were close. Our staff does a great job of getting them on campus, and then our staff has done a great job, and when they get off campus during the contact period, we don't just get in and out of schools. Our coaches have done a great job of getting in there. They may spend 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 hours at one place, whether it be at the school or the home or going to dinner with some of these folks and just spend the time. So I think the relationship piece that you've heard me talk about for years is still most important, you know, to have those strong relationships with these players and with these prospects. And so I think it's a combination of things. I think it was the leadership. I think it was the staff doing a great job and us really staying on it and really pushing for that unity this year.
Mark, you've been around a lot of great DBs, coached a lot of them in the past. Where does this group, the three guys, kind of rate on paper going into this?
Very high, very high. You know, we'll see, but just looking on paper and looking at what I've seen over the years and who we really wanted and who we targeted, you know, it's a great group. And, you know, that's where it gets dicey, because if you have a defection and you can't go recruit more, because then they start looking at you saying, hey, coach, you got four corners, you got guys on your staff, you know, and that gets touchy, because you always want to have some depth, because if you lose one, you lose two, that's where it hurts you. That's where it hurts you, that's where it hurts your program, that's where it hurts your class. So to see those bookends, you know, stay the course, I think was real key. But they're a very talented group.
Mark, with this class, how close do you feel you're getting to the type of depth you need, not just for success, but sustained success?
Yeah, I think that's, you know, something that we talk about in this room, and you hear me talking about it all the time, and, you know, heck, it is what it is. You know, there's no, you know, nobody cares. You've heard me joke about it before. Nobody cares what your problems are. You know, nobody cares in this league, that's for darn sure. But you need to stack classes on top of classes on top of classes. And then you need to develop them, and you need to put them in position by coaching. So there's a lot of things that go into it, but it absolutely starts with having great players. Just take a good look around. You know, take a good look around our league and what we do, and we feel very good about this class. And again, take a look around where we stand. Now, the good thing is, you know, wherever your slot is, 9, 10, whatever in the SEC, it's a lot closer than being way off. You know what I mean? The balance is getting closer.
Mark, one of your early signees that have been talked about a whole lot is Gunnar Hoke. He committed kind of to one offensive staff and stayed with you. How important was that, and kind of what do you project and see and like about him?
I think it's very important for Gunnar. As you know, as things turned out, you know, with some of the guys on our team, it was extremely important to keep Gunnar because of depth in his ability. You're right, because he's a quiet kid. He's been committed. He's kind of under the radar, but he's a terrific football player. He's a great leader, and I tell you, our players have been extremely impressed with him. Our receivers have been out throwing with him, and they said that he could spin the heck out of the ball, and he has a great touch, and he's really doing a good job out there throwing. So he's a guy we're very excited about, and I'm excited to get out there this spring and see what he can do and see him compete for playing time. So I'm very high on Gunnar.
We're going to get asked if this is your best recruiting class, so would you answer that for us?
Yeah, I definitely do. I believe so. Yeah, I feel that way. I don't know where the numbers stack up. I don't really care. I mean, from my point of view, absolutely top to bottom, I feel like it's the most solid group. I feel like there's elite talent in this group, and I feel like there's great glue. There's great players. There's great program guys. There's guys that you can develop. There's guys that can play right away. There's impact guys. There's guys that change the scoreboard. There's guys that could get extremely difficult yards when you need them in the run game. We got the big uglies that we always want. You know, so I think there's a nice combination of guys in this group, and I definitely do. And I think it can't be stated enough. Going back to the question of why they stayed so close together, I think it just shows a lot about this group's character and who they are. They're exactly who I want and who we want in this program. And they're great kids that are, football is extremely important. Take a guy like Landon, 5-star, you know, and all that. We signed him when he was, you know, 6'6" and buck 80, you know, joking. But that very tall, skinny guy, and just developed and worked. But the great thing about Landon is that he, I'm sure he's proud of that. I know that. I've talked to him and his family, and that's great recognition for him. But he feels it more for us or for the program or giving credibility and all that. It's not about him. You know, he knows he's got to come in here and compete and play. And he's so humble that, you know, that's what I think you take him all the way down to everybody in our class. They're very humble, and they're excited about playing football. They're serious about the game. And they're not so wrapped up in all the stars and all the, you know, all that kind of stuff. They want to get in here and get to work. And that's what I love about this group, top to bottom. There's enough characters. I mean, you got Cash in there. But, but the great thing about Cash is, again, just listening to him up there today, he spoke so well. He was on the broadcast. And you know, he's a great personality that I think everybody in this state will love, and our players certainly love. But he's a worker, man. He wants to get in that weight room and work, and he wants to get on the field and work, and that's what you want.
Mark, what kind of challenges? I know you mentioned that you were able to keep the class together, but what kind of challenges did you face with so many coaching changes and a few that were late in the year?
Very little. Very, very little challenges with the coaching changes. You know, so I think the guys that came in picked it up quickly. Our staff really had a great fix on it. We were very much ahead of it in that regard. I really focused on that this year. If there was a lead guy, I really made sure we backed it up with a lot of guys. Vince will be the first one to tell you. You know, Vince gets a lot of credit, and he deserves it because he's recruited well and closed on a lot of guys. But our staff absolutely hammers away at the positions, and we really follow it up with 2 and 3 and 4. And really, our whole staff recruits everybody. You know, we have one guy on point, but we have everybody else that's very active, and I think that's why we help everybody. Wake up, Lou.
Vince? Is this, I was wanting to ask you about last year in terms of, I know this is another year, but anyway, was last year somewhat of an anomaly with UK as well as around the country and the decommits as many as it was around the country last year?
Yeah, I think it's something to that. I didn't see too many decommits this year. But, you know, last year, we just, our belief is we got kids here on campus more than 2 times or 3 times. They pretty much stay committed. Probably 3 of the guys that decommitted, they was going to hear about probably once or twice. So, and then the number one team in the country came after them. So, you know, that was hard to hold on to. But, yeah, I see a little bit of that.
And again, piggybacking on that, you see the decommits. I mean, I'm watching briefly, just ESPN in between, just getting ready for this. And you seeing all the flipping going on, you know, with major players. It's part of the game. And nobody likes to see it. Fans don't like to see it, but there's nobody that panics. I mean, it doesn't help you. Sometimes it's a kick in the gut instead of kicking the other thing. But it's a kick in the gut sometimes. You don't like it because recruiting is very personal. And coaches spend an awful lot of time recruiting these guys. And that's what gets hard when guys play games to you. But that's why at the end of the day, anybody that's going to sit right in my office and right in my eyes and lie to me, I absolutely don't want them in this program. So, you know, it all works out for the best most of the time. Yeah.
Mark, even as highly talented as your offensive linemen are in this class, how realistic is it to expect them to make immediate impact?
Yeah, I think that's a big thing that people, you know, got to put the brakes on a bit because, and that's the problem, as you know, the balance that I have. Everybody, we're recruiting, yeah, we got to develop them, and it takes years, and we're at that point. We're going in year 4. We expect to win. We expect our players to be at a high level, you know, much more physical than we've been, more talented, all those things, so it got to equate to wins. With the young guys that are here, at O-line in particular, sometimes that's very difficult to do, O-line and D-line. I mean, that's a physical game. Now, with that being said, I think a guy like Drake is one of the most technique-sound guys I've seen coming out of high school in a long, long time. And I think Landon is most definitely, one of the more talented true freshman linemen I've ever been with. And that means any school. So I think he's got great upside, and he's a worker, he's humble, and he wants to play. And so I think they have a good chance. And, of course, Tate, he's not a high school guy, so we expect him to come in and be ready.
We're here, Tim Sullivan.
Mark, Jim Harbaugh has raised the bar at least visibly this year with sleepovers.
Is that what you call it?
Well, Derek Jeter, Tom Brady, Ric Flair is signing today. Do you feel that there's a pressure or an arms race in that regard in terms of the way you go about recruiting?
No, I think that, if I'm not mistaken, I think that cause is for raising money and it's benefiting cancer, and I think that's a great cause. And, you know, it's my understanding, and I don't know a lot about it, but I think he's tying that into a fundraiser for Coach Carr's grandson and all that. So I think that's a great idea. And anything, you know, that you could tie in and use, you know, this platform or his platform to raise money for a cause like that, that's wonderful. And I'm all for it. Some of the other shenanigans, not with Coach, but with other people, are the craziness that goes on. I mean, you know, at some point we all do things maybe that we're not real proud of, you know what I mean? But I'm not going to tell you all the things we do, you know what I mean? So we have to do a lot of times to land recruits, and sometimes you got to put your pride aside, you know what I mean? And you have to do what you have to do, and we all work that, and we all get humbled by this process, but we work extremely hard. But the shenanigans and some of that that goes on throughout the country, you know, we're not too big into all that.
Okay.